Good evening, everyone. We will commence with the second session for the day, which is a panel discussion and the fourth session of the conference, which is a panel discussion moderated by the conference convener, Professor Amitav Malik, where we will try to explore the solutions explore how the solutions and research discussed so far can be realized into action and how to gain momentum for it. We are fortunate to have a distinguished set of panelists with very wide experience for this session. So the four panelists which we have for this session are Dr. Anupam Saraf. He will talk on limitations to environmental and economic synergy and ecological integrity. He is a future designer and a leadership strategy and innovation mentor. He has been an advisor in governance, informatics, and strategic planning for many governments and organizations. Our next speaker is Dr. Sarachandra Lele, who will talk on environmentally responsible economic growth. He is a distinguished fellow in environmental policy and governance at the Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and Environment. He has expertise in interdisciplinary research in ecology, economics, and political science. Our next speaker is Dr. L.S. Shashidhara, who will talk on innovation and governance for a sustainable future. Dr. Shashidhara is a professor at Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, ISER Pune, and Ashoka University. He is also the president of the International Union of Biological Sciences, IUBS, and is steering an international project on climate change education. The last speaker for the session is Mr. Arvind Karandikar, who will talk on technology challenges for net carbon neutrality. He's the managing director at Nexus Energy Tech and specializes in strategic planning, project management, techno-commercial consultancy in green projects. My colleagues Prithvi Raj and Siddharth will also join the session to share youth perspectives and some questions. I now request Professor Malik to share his views and please start the session.
Thank you, Aditi. I hope everyone, I am audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Welcome to the speakers of this session. But this is going to be a session on panel discussion. It will be a very different kind of a, this has been a very different kind of a conference. We have not really talked about the typical climate change conference. We are calling it a climate economics conference. So we have not really looked at the biodiversity loss or air pollution and all that, but we have looked at the interface or the interdependence of economy and environment. By environment, of course, the major facet of environment we are talking about is the climate change. So last three sessions, we have focused on understanding the interrelationship, then what way low carbon economic pathways can be contributive. And of course, recently, today, the third session was on dynamics of energy in India. What has emerged is very alarming in a way, very challenging in a very different way. We heard Dr. Rahul Panandikar announced and share his understanding that by 2050, we will probably be the largest emitter in the world. Today, we are the third. There are many other issues that have been discussed where we realized that the actual scenario is far more grim than one would like to think. So we are here today in this panel discussion to talk about solutions, talk about approaches that can take us out of this very critical period into something that can be a little more forward-looking. We need to probably look at identify targets that are achievable in about next 10 years. In short, saving the environment must become profitable. I know it sounds that everything ultimately depends upon the economy, but we are in that paradigm today that unless we can make a whatever we need to do, unless it is economically acceptable, economically profitable, things may not happen. And of course, we know that renewable energy is one area where it is win-win, and yet not enough is happening, not enough momentum is gathering. At the same time, we know that it's only a part of the solution, not the whole solution. So we are looking at other sectors that are not other than renewable energy. Agriculture could be one, food supply could be one, moving away from chemical to organic could be a major challenge. Water sector is also important because water scarcity can boomerang into all kinds of things that will take us backward. And of course, ultimately, it is the efficiency you must talk about, whether it is efficiency in energy, material, processes, and even human efficiency, which is productivity, which will go down as the temperature goes up. So this is a whole lot of things that we need to discuss today. We have shared our thoughts with the panelist speakers. We have suggested some topics, but they are free to talk whatever they want to. And we are requesting each panel speaker to take about 8-9 minutes. And then we open it for the discussion, and each panel speaker can choose to come in again and say something more or something different. So may I start this session by inviting Dr. Anupam Saraf as the first speaker. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Amitav, and thank you for the introduction. Let me just share my screen. Good evening to everybody. I want to start with biologist Conrad Lorenz. He demonstrated that when ducklings hatch, they are imprinted to follow anyone who imitates the mother duck sounds. In our urban world, many of us have grown up with an economy long before we encountered the environment. Naturally, we have been imprinted to believe that economics is the foundation of our existence. We have grown up evaluating the value of everything in money and power, not beauty, care, or respect. The environment for many is just something out there to visit for vacation or to own a farmhouse. Psychologist Skinner demonstrated that if the consequences of an action are good, it will be repeated. If the consequences are bad, it may not be repeated. Economic principles reward actions which are based on gains of money, not of reverence, beauty, care, or respect. Economic principles have no reverence. For them, there is nothing that is sacred, nothing that is of any value, other than when exchanged or traded for a consideration of currency. Economic principles allow us to reward bad consequences that destroy the sacred, show irreverence, and are uncaring and even disrespectful, or even destroy life. Let's note that over the last 59 years, perhaps the lifetime of many of you who are listening to this conference, we have increased in numbers from just about 3 billion to more than 7 billion. In India alone, we have grown from about 450 million in 1960 to about 1.3 billion in 2019. Our global GDP grew from about a trillion in 1960 to $86 trillion in 2020. That's more than a 30-fold increase per capita. And for India, it's a 75-fold GDP growth from 37 billion to 2.8 trillion Indian rupees in just 59 years from 1960 to 2019. Why hasn't this phenomenal growth solved India's inequality, its hunger, its shelter, its intolerance, its health, its unsustainability, environmental destruction, or the climate crisis. So 73 years after independence, India is amongst the worst performers, leaving its people hungry and malnourished. Over 18% of the urban households are living in poor conditions. It has unpotable and insufficient water supply, overflowing solid waste and sewage. Our rivers, forests, and even mountains are being exploited, encroached, and polluted as we are unable to halt our material and economic greed propagated by urbanization. We have serious failures of tolerance, human dignity, equality, liberty, and justice. So although the economy has made all these issues worse, we keep repeating economic decisions as they reward us, especially those who make them, in the short term. We now push for green energy as a solution to the world's ills, forgetting that it continues to push the short-term economic gains that will continue to make the problems worse. We seem to miss out that our global energy use grew from 2 trillion to about 13 trillion kilogram oil equivalent, or a 6.5-fold increase from 1960 to 2014. And that for every gigajoule of energy that we use, it results in extracting, using, and discarding more materials. It increases our consumerism. It allows us to go on as if nothing is wrong about the economic decisions that we make. It results in economic activities that cause the destruction of our mountains, rivers, forests, faster and faster, with machines running on energy that do not fatigue or respond to the destruction that we are unleashing. And consequently, destroying biodiversity, nature's biogeochemical cycles, the climate and the weather that sustain life on Earth. We move from more energy intensive farming, changing the economics for the farmer and consequently unleashing social consequences. We make more and more powerful machines running on energy to do everything faster, accelerating the destruction of a livable planet. In our greed to have everything now, we are killing the goose that lays the golden eggs. Notice that in just 26 years from 1990 to 2016, the forest area we have per unit of GDP dropped sevenfold. Even as we continue to use more of the planet to extract the resources that we need, we have a sevenfold less nature to absorb the consequences of our economic activity. In India, this has decreased almost eightfold in 26 years, from a dismal 2.3 to a 0.3 square meters per Indian rupee of GDP. And while we did that, we have been busy rewarding the few who made the decisions and made the world unequal. In India, the top 10% have been rewarded with more than 65% wealth. In 2012, the bottom 50% with only 5%. And every year that they voted for the economy over the environment, the top 10% were rewarded by earning more than 55% of the national income, while the bottom 50% earned less than 5%. And they continued to make our environment less and less livable. Yet we have never asked the question, how much economic activity per square kilometer leaves the planet habitable? Did you know that India increased the GDP per square kilometer 813-fold, from 12,000 Indian rupees to almost a million Indian rupees per square kilometer from 1960 to 2018? since it is the economy and energy use that is imprinted on us, we have not asked what is the energy per hectare or the energy per capita that would be ethical, respectful, and caring for the community of life, not just for humans on Earth. What is the GDP per hectare that is caring and respectful of our planet? Isn't it time that we recognize that our challenge is not about growing the economy? It is about containing our human greed for more and more and our human lust for power. The challenge is of ensuring that the planet remains habitable, that there is equity, justice, and end of hunger. Isn't it time that we scale down human activity per hectare to that which is respectful and caring of the community of life that ensures ecological integrity? Shouldn't our business models be focused on serving the local community, not on selfish ambitions of mindless greed, creating global or national monopolies or economic growth? Shouldn't these business models have immediate consequences for harm they do to the environment and rewards for the good that they do to the environment? And finally, shouldn't we actually recognize that the problem is not the source of energy? An economy driven by fossil fuels or renewables is still an economy, irreverent, uncaring, disrespectful to the community of life, exploiting the planet and rewarding the destruction of that which sustains life. Isn't it time to accept that we are addicted to ambition, greed, and economic and social structures we have built that reward unethical behavior? Isn't it time that we rebuild an ethical society that respects and cares for the planet and the community of life? Isn't it time our children recognized that the environment as their true mother of life, not the economy that has been imprinted on us by those who are rewarded by the economy? Isn't it? I would like to end with the hope that we shall all rise to shoulder our part to take care and respect the community of life and the planet that sustains us all. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Anupam sir, for summarizing so many different issues related to environment and ecosystems and how they could be analyzed. And I can totally relate to the expressions of those caricatures. So thanks a lot for the presentation too. Our next speaker is Dr. Sharat Chandra Lele, who will talk about environmentally responsible economic growth. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Just make sure that my screen is visible. Is it visible?
Yes.
All well.
Thank you to the Pune International Center and the organizers of this conference in particular for inviting me. A big thank you to Anupam for making my task easier by raising some really important questions. I know this session is about solutions, but I think it's really important that when we say look for solutions, we look for them in the direction that we want to go. So the direction in which we want to go, I think we need to have a little bit more clarity about that, because otherwise, we will be looking for solutions which take us in a different direction altogether. And in that context, I must say that I was also alarmed when some speaker, and that point was repeated actually, that by 2050, India could become the largest emitter of CO2. And I was alarmed not because of the number or that possibility, but because of the framing of the problem. When we say largest emitter, we say that something terrible, but really we shouldn't we be looking at it on a per capita basis, because there is nothing like measuring CO2 on a national basis. It doesn't mean anything. It would be similar to saying that by 2050, India would have the third largest GDP in the world, but we would still be on a per capita basis poorer than about 50 other countries on this planet. So what is the point in talking about GDP in gross terms? What is the point in talking about CO2 emissions in gross terms? And that points to the core problem or challenge I have in front of me, because the session and the conference is about economy, energy, and energy, environment, and economic growth. And I think there is a component that is missing, So even the topic given to me, environmentally responsible economic growth, I would actually like to reframe as environmentally sound and socially just, but also democratic development. And there are, given the limited time, I'm just going to make a few points as to how these two are different and in what way. So the first point really is that economic growth is absolutely the wrong goal to strive for. We should be looking for development. I'm sorry, I don't know why this is doing a blue line, but we should be looking for development, which is a certain level of well-being, and that well-being is material, spiritual, and social. It cannot be measured in monetary terms. And that well-being has to be for all and forever. So that has to be really our goal and not economic growth. The second point to remember is that even those who say, well, we are not really aiming for economic growth. Our ultimate goal is development, sustainable development. And economic growth is a means to that end. I think it's really important for us to understand that economic growth is neither necessary nor sufficient for such development. Just because you have high GDP growth rates does not mean that you really have improved well-being for all. And just because you have low GDP growth rates does not mean that your well-being is not improving. We have many models within our country as well as outside which show with lower GDPs, lower GDP growth rates, people are still actually happier and overall in a space of better well-being. So I think it's really important to completely remove economic growth as the goal from our conversations and really talk about meaningful development, development which is not just, again, about economic development, but the goal being that of well-being for all and forever. The second point is the idea of environmentally responsible. And I think we need to unpack this idea of environmentally responsible, because throughout this conference and many other conferences, many other workshops, we quickly fall into the trap of equating environmentally responsible to sustainable to carbon neutral, make these very easy equations. And there's no question that environmentalism includes a concern for the future. And therefore, the idea of sustainability has emerged very strongly. The Brundtland Commission in 1987 made that as kind of the centerpiece of its contribution, that we do need to have the kind of development that will not undermine our future. Yes, that's absolutely true. And many environmental problems display this this propensity or this feature where what we are doing today will undermine our well-being tomorrow. The overpumping of groundwater in many parts of India is just one example where we will benefit today by cultivating sugarcane or cultivating paddy or cultivating other water-intensive crops, but at the cost of the future. So definitely the future is one thing that environmentalism points us to, but there are other dimensions to environmentalism. And environmentalism includes, for example, the notion of environmental justice, because many environmental problems are not about the future. They are about the here and now. If I emit pollutants and dump them in the river, I'm destroying somebody else's life today. I'm destroying somebody else's health today. I'm destroying some aquatic ecosystem today. So it's not about the future. And in fact, the water is always taking it away from me towards somebody else. And that, therefore, I will never suffer. So my sustainability is not at stake if I continue to emit these pollutants into a one-way traffic of a downstream flow or a downwind flow of pollutants. And that is really, really important for us to understand. A lot of environmental problems are problems of environmental justice and not problems of environmental sustainability, because it is about one person's gain at somebody else's cost through the environmental process. And even in the problem of climate change, we see that there are people who have benefited by past historical emissions, and now they are saying, well, let's just forget about all that and let's just look at current emissions. There are people, of course, they're not willing to talk about it in per capita emissions. And also, we know that there are some countries which are going to suffer much more than other countries. In fact, Russia might benefit from climate change because the tundra will actually melt, and then you could have excellent agricultural and opening up of mineral resource exploitation in the tundra. So we have to really remember that all environmental problems often have a justice dimension. Many of them are only environmental justice problems, and those are about one person's actions hurting somebody else through an environmental process. And the third thing that environmentalism teaches us is about our definition of quality of life. As Anupam started off right in the beginning by saying, we are so habituated to living in an urban environment and thinking that skyscrapers is the notion of development, that we forget what environmentalism is trying to point out to us, that there is something else to quality of life, not just being able to build a bigger skyscraper or live in an air-conditioned office where we can then watch National Geographic Channel on TV. But there's something else to quality of life, which is about going out there and enjoying nature, right, immediately in our environments, not just, you know, traveling 500 kilometers in an SUV and then watching tigers for 2 days and coming back to our air-conditioned offices, but really having a green nature right outside our doors or inside our rooms for that matter. So the second point is that really environmental responsibility or environmentally responsible development has these dimensions of sustainability, justice, and environmental quality of life that we need to unpack and reintegrate into our goals. And still missing from this is the dimension of social justice, because people are not the same. People are not in the same positions of power and ability. There are huge disparities. And again, Anupam made an excellent presentation on the inequalities in Indian society today. So a 1 rupee impact on my income is not the same as a 1 rupee impact on a daily wage laborer's income. So measuring, and that's one of the problems with environmental economics. Even when it tries to correct GDP, it measures the economic value of environmental impacts and subtracts that from GDP. But really, if the impacts are all on the poor, then the economic value of that environmental impact is going to be very low. And then, you know, you'll find that, well, we can just, our GDP only needs to be corrected by a few fractions, and we don't really need to worry about too much the environmental impact that it is causing. So the whole issue of social justice, which is freedom from discrimination, equality of opportunity, and this discrimination can be on class dimensions, caste dimensions, and gender dimensions, to just name the three most prominent ways in which discrimination exists in our society today. And freedom of thought and expression. So I think this whole dimension is missing. If we say energy, environment, and economic growth, we have missed out the whole question of equity, both environmental equity or environmental justice and social justice. And finally, I think there is a procedural dimension here, because you and I can never fully agree on these goals. We can never fully agree on the exact definitions or the exact thresholds or the priority to give one versus the other, and so on and so forth. So how do we actually take decisions? Throughout the conference, I've been hearing people say, we should do this, we should do that, we should do this, we should not do that. But the question, who is this we? What is the process through which we actually take these decisions? And I think we need to remember and remind ourselves that neither centralized planning, which we sort of tried a little bit in the early decades of independence, nor the invisible hand of the market, nor even a sort of environmentally corrected market, as I mentioned, can really work and help us take the correct decisions. There is no one correct decision. Once you have multiple incommensurable and to an extent unknowable values, we don't even know how people care about the tiger or how people care about their life or about their material well-being. We don't really know. We just make assumptions and move forward. So given these incommensurable and unknowable values, we cannot sit on the top and say we know roughly what people want, and then we'll add and subtract and we'll come to the sort of quote-unquote optimal decisions. Also, because what environmentalism teaches us is there are multiple externalities operating, and there is no free lunch. A point that Nitant Mate made and that Anupam made, that even renewable energy comes with costs. There is nothing like absolutely green renewable energy. There's nothing like a costless solution or technological solution to any environmental problem. And there is no we. I think it's really, really important for us to come back to this point of who is this we, when you say we should do this, we should do that, we care about this, but some, you know, dirty politician does not care about this. It's sort of, you know, that's really oversimplifying the problem. The fact is that my consumption often comes at somebody else's cost. If my electricity is coming from Eastern Maharashtra or from Chhattisgarh, from Jharkhand, then it's the Adivasis in that region who have given up their forest for the coal mining, who have given up their land for the thermal power plant, and who are breathing all the coal dust and the emissions from the thermal power plants. And I am not affected by that that whole production process. So there is no we. If we ask them, their answers to questions of whether that plant should come up or not would be very different from my answers in terms of just looking at, you know, the cost of electricity for me. So we need to move the discourse from just talking about, you know, looking for an overlap between growth and environment, which gives us only oxymorons in the intersection, to something like maybe environment, economics, and equity, the three E's. And it's still only a sort of a very simplistic take on the whole problem, I would say. And maybe something slightly more complicated like material well-being, non-material quality of life, equity and justice, sustainability and resilience, but also democracy as the fifth pillar, the fifth goal, in this whole process. And I'll end with a few simple steps because I know the time given for us is very, very short. And this was a session on solutions. My first solution is look in the right direction and not look in the direction of economic growth. So stop watching that ticker tape, the ticker tape that runs under every news, in every news channel, on every TV program, and the newscaster is talking about riots in Delhi or farmers' agitation in Punjab. The ticker tape is talking about how the share market is going up and down. And I think the first thing we need to do is stop watching that ticker tape, because that ticker tape is extremely misleading. The share market does not convey anything other than a continuous opinion poll of about, you know, a 0.25% of the high income households who speculate in the share market. That's about all that the share market prices are telling us. So we need to stop watching that ticker tape. We should need to stop watching the ticker tape about GDP growth, and we need to really focus on actual measures of well-being, on measures of quality of life. And as I think everybody in this room belongs to sort of the middle and upper middle classes, and therefore we have already crossed a certain level of a certain threshold of minimum well-being, we need to start monitoring our own footprints, both the direct footprints and the embedded footprints. And just to give you one example, if the direct footprint of my water consumption in my house is about, let us say, 150 liters per capita per day, the indirect footprint as measured through the consumption, the water consumption in growing the food that I ate and producing the industrial goods that I consume, is about 1500 to 3000 liters per capita per day. So that's the kind of difference we need to be looking for, looking at the indirect footprints. Number three, do not believe that technology will fix everything. I know a lot of the discussion today was about renewable energy technologies, different kinds of energy technologies and other solutions. And absolutely, technology is going to be part of the solution. But if we believe that techno fixes will solve all problems, we don't need to change. We don't need to change social structures. Because again, there is an assumption of a free lunch. I think we have lost the game. And therefore, because there is no free lunch, and because different people are affected differently, we need to democratize in all environment and development decisions. And I'll just list out four or five steps that are very tangible in today's world. I'm not talking about sort of very esoteric stuff. So we need to sort of strengthen and regain the RTI process, which on a daily basis is being gutted by this government and by the courts by saying X and Y information will not be available. We need to strengthen the Forest Rights Act. The implementation is abysmal, and it's only through granting rights to communities to the environment in which they live that we can actually hope to have a just decision making on these things. We need to strengthen the environmental clearance process. I was on the environmental clearance committees for coal mining and thermal power, and I know how badly sabotaged that whole process is. And we really need to strengthen this environmental clearance process. We need to strengthen the forest clearance process, which has also been badly sabotaged. And we need to introduce processes where they don't exist. And I'll give you only two examples. One is on the water rights context, that groundwater, for example, is a free-for-all in terms of exploitation rights. And therefore, we need to start thinking about how we will talk about water rights and about the pollution control boards, how to make pollution control boards accountable, transparent, and open to scrutiny, but also with the representation of people on their governing bodies in order to actually make them do what they're supposed to do. These are one of the weakest environmental regulatory authorities in the country, but also in the world, I think, in terms of what the Act says and how they function on the ground. So these are some very tangible steps that we can take, but we always need to remember where we want to go. And that's not just environment and economy, but it's really about environmentally sound, socially just, and democratic development. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for shifting the focus from growth to development, and for the elaborate presentation. I will now request Dr. L.S. Shashidhara to talk on innovation and governance for a sustainable future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thanks for this opportunity. So I'm more into education and education policy. I'm actually a teacher. So what I'll do is I'll sort of bring in the component of education in this. And Dr. Lele has really very nicely articulated some of the aspects of environmental justice and equity, environmental equity and such kind of issues. So I'm sure, I mean, I don't have to sort of go through all of these things, but the challenges that we always be talking about for the last several years, that what we are facing today and what we may face more of them tomorrow, in this very unpredictability of the future. In fact, much of what we wanted to do in modern living and modern societies is about how to, you know, have a more precise prediction of the future. That, you know, much of the science was all about predicting the future and then trying to prepare ourselves for the future. And actually, it is actually having a boomerang effect because of the climate change, that future is becoming more and more uncertain and unpredictable. And in, you know, the second one, everybody was talking about there would be an epidemic or more of pandemics and kind of stuff. And we are actually going through a pandemic. And no one really, although in 2004 and 2006, very large number of articles came that there could be, you know, another pandemic like the Spanish flu 100 years ago. But no one sort of could predict that it could be, you know, as early as in 2020. Now, the issue is about, you know, how to deal with these kind of, you know, situation, right? Now, what is that we need to do? Because I'm supposed to sort of focus more on the governance and really dealing with these kind of issues, is centralized governance. I think Dr. Lelia has already, you know, articulated about it. It's untenable, right? In fact, as, you know, physicists say, larger the organized system, more expensive it is, more energy expensive it is, right? You can never have green economy when you have governance more centralized in a country like ours, which is huge country, very diverse, you know, looking at, you know, the not only geoclimatic diversity, there's huge human diversity and, you know, very large population, 1.3 billion people, right? And having an organized structure for this is extremely expensive. You want to think of, you know, the way just simply a market, the way moving, the commodity movement, people movement across the country, and simply the very governance itself is extremely energy expensive, right? And the laws of physics very clear, right? More the energy you use, more will be the entropy, right? And more the size of a system, more the energy is required to just maintain it as a system, right? And larger the system, and more the complex network, more is the energy consumption and less green it is, right? So we need to really think very differently to deal with this such kind of a, you know, problem that we are facing today. This we created ourselves, obviously, right? It's simply because society became larger and larger. We never really thought that, you know, we would sort of get into kind of situation where we are now. So obviously most people have already spoken about this. Many, many people have talked about what we need to do is more localized economy, or you can call it as more localized sustainable living rather than using even the word economy. And I would bring back, you know, what almost everybody all over the world is talking about is what we need to go back is Gandhian economy, right? And that should be real, the green economy or green sustainable living. So coming back to some of the my own experience while dealing with educational policy and developing innovative educational methods in the context of climate change and addressing the problems of climate change. One is, of course, you know, the concepts of science, concept of understanding of the societal dynamics and societal problems are more global. But solutions have to be more local. So what we call as locally rooted solution to problems, but you know, the solutions can actually come from the science which is more globally relevant, right? Now, the as you can say, impact of the climate change, it's felt across the world, but it's nature of the impact varies from location to location. There are extreme weather conditions. Some places may have high rain, more rains, some may have less rains or more cold or less, much warmer places and so forth, right? So obviously we need locally rooted solutions for this. You know, we need to educate people across the world because everybody should understand the cause and impact of the climate change, and then they have to look for their own innovative solutions. Having again one globalized technology is not going to give a proper solution to this. People are talking about carbon capture technologies and kind of things. Again, they are not going to, you know, globally solve the problem because the problems are different in different locations. We need more innovative solutions to each one of these locations. So the what we need to do is, of course, democratize the knowledge. Knowledge is being generated across the world, maybe more so in some parts of the world, you know, and compared to the other parts of the world. But access to knowledge which is relevant knowledge for green economy or green sustainable living, should be made available because of the advantage of the digital world, it should be democratized. As Dr. Lele mentioned, about we had to democratize many of the other aspects of society. And I would first say, democratize the knowledge, everything that is researched and understood about the nature of the world and how the climate change is caused and how, what is the impact of the climate change. That knowledge should be democratized and made available everywhere in the world so that whole humanity will actually look for a solution of its own, right? Because it's very given that if you know the problem and cause of the problem, you will also think about the right solution. So let people think for their own solutions rather than trying to look for a centralized solution. What we need to give is the knowledge first. So I'll just give you one example of how this has helped in some parts, because I'm running an international project on climate change education. And one of the things we are trying to do is to develop a curricular system where climate change topics are integrated in every discipline, whether you're talking about, humanities, social science, or natural sciences, in school or undergraduate level, you bring in climate change concept in a very seamlessly integrated with the core curriculum rather than a co-curricular or extracurricular activity. Awareness of climate change should not just because, this is like a general knowledge, you should know about it. It should be part of, the whole educational system itself. So one of the things we were developing a lesson plan, typically how a teacher would use in a classroom was something about how photosynthetic pathway. There are very different, physiological response, physiological processes like in the plant system. And when we teach this and how the, physiological response to climate change will happen because of the way the photosynthesis is being affected with climate change. And this is the one we were basically, we're organizing a workshop in Uganda as part of our program. And some of the Ugandan teachers came out with their own local lesson plan where they were talking about the growth of bamboo, how it is sort of more of green and sustainable for their local environment and how their climate change impact is different and bamboo growth would be a sustainable solution for that one. And bamboo for good is kind of a lesson plan they made, and utility of the science of growing bamboo, its utility in variety of different ways, including for conservation of gorilla, and which is one of the endangered species, and how it sort of helps in tourism. They integrated the whole thing, and now they are teaching this kind of a lesson plan across the many districts of Uganda, which is very locally local problem for them, but they're also teaching the high science, like the plant physiology, photosynthesis, chemistry, and the biology of the photosynthesis and so forth. And so this is the kind of education initiative has actually helped so locally for people to understand the importance of some of the sustainable solutions. What I'm trying to sort of end saying that decentralize the governance, decentralize the educational modules, but democratize the knowledge so that access to all the high science, high knowledge is available to everybody. Let them find their own solutions to the problems. That's where I'll stop. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, sir. We also are thinking on how communication helps and what can be done, and you have given such a nice example and the importance of science-based learning, which was not touched upon in the conference very specifically. So thanks a lot for covering that. Our next speaker is Mr. Arvind Karandikar, who will talk on technology challenges for net carbon neutrality. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Aditi. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
And the screen?
Yes, we can see the screen.
So thank you, organizers. Thank you, Professor Malik, to give me this opportunity. Of course, being the last speaker and given only 7-8 minutes puts me in a spot. And that is because I am going to talk about technology challenges for for net carbon neutrality. That was a topic given to me. In last 2 days, over 4 sessions, a lot of people have talked about these things. Why I'm showing this here is only to discuss what technology we are talking about and what technology we should be talking about. But later on, I will also talk about how technology is not the only thing. But what I can show here, or what you can see here, is definitely carbon dioxide is one of the major gases that we need to control, reduce, and then capture also. And then what are the sectors that are actually contributing to these global greenhouse gas emissions? We use technology term in a very generalistic way. But what exactly we mean by technology? First is availability. Availability is not that in some lab or somewhere in say Europe or America or somewhere, some technology is available and we say, yes, this technology is available to fight climate change. So what is the scale of operation of a particular technology? What is its appropriateness to global level, to national level, to regional level, to me as an individual? What is the appropriate technology available, whether it is available or not? And then ease of maintenance. Introducing technology is comparatively easy as compared to maintaining it, operating it for many years so that real advantage from the technology can be achieved. Then further, we talk about how the dissemination of technology happens and whether particular dissemination has really happened of a technology that we say that is available. So what is the speed? What is the procedure of lab to land or a factory to field? Is there enough human resource which is skilled enough to disseminate this technology, which we say is available for particular operation, for particular purpose? And then finally, what is the profitability of that technology to a particular region or a village or an individual? Because we want to have an appropriate technology. When we want to adopt any technology, there are different barriers that we can see. First is definitely the information and knowledge that any individual who should be adopting the technology, he has information and knowledge. Ease of ownership. Yes, many people would be very passionate to do something about environment and ecology, but ease of ownership will be a major issue if we really want to adopt any technology. Access to finance. We had some good sessions about how green finance is available or not. And then access to finance is another barrier that we can see, or the factor that we should be talking about. And technology is not something that, yes, today I have a technology about a particular XYZ and that is it. Now we want to disseminate and adopt it. No, technology needs to develop continuously, and that does so. So if we really adopt anything, whether we can also keep pace with the continuous development in the technology. Finally, economics. What is the economics of a particular technology that we are talking about? Small is beautiful. Then are the technologies available are really small, really adoptable at individual and village level? What are the increasing costs that we don't many a time take into account while disseminating or adopting a technology? There is also some people have talked about a lot of corruption, a lot of cash economy, the sustenance. So these are the things that we should be talking about technology. Not only technology availability is not the only concern that we should have. But said that, are the technologies available? So let us see very, very, very few of the technologies where we can say, yes, technologies are available. For example, definitely our aim is to control emissions, so reduce carbon generation. Again, many people have talked about this. Renewable energy is one major example that, again, many people have talked. But hydrogen is upcoming technology, but there are already plants available in hydrogen generation. About vehicular emission reduction, lot of things have happened, and we have seen that at least in few cities, few vehicles with lot of emission norms that are being developed, the emissions reduction is possible. So in this way, And there are, of course, many more. In 7-8 minutes, we cannot go over each and every technology. What I want to show here is, yes, if you want to reduce or control carbon emissions, there are technologies available. Then what about that carbon which is already in nature, in atmosphere, or the other one which will definitely be emission, which will be definitely be emitted because of lot of economic activities. So are the technologies available for removal? Some are nature based. We always say that plant more trees, afforestation, reforestation, reclaiming lands that have been degraded. Marine, there is also actually enhanced natural processes available, which have been tried and tested at few places. We cannot say globally replicable technologies, but yes, those are available. Lot of research or lot of developments are taking place in technology-based solutions. You might have heard about bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, or even direct air capture storage. There are plants on both these technologies which are operational and which are doing this, capturing the carbon, storing it in either the ground or the earth, or also in the marine biology. So technology availability is not a major constraint, because that was the topic I was given. What can be the major constraint? You can see here two different sets of, I would say, technologies or solutions. On left, what we can see, this is pertaining to India I'm talking about. So energy efficiency, we have seen a very good drive by government. Whatever limited technology we had this energy efficiency for lighting. We also had many energy efficiency drives for industries, manufacturing sectors, and so on. We also went ahead and did this certification on energy efficiency of various products, air conditioners, refrigerators, and so on. Solar mission is very well known, and that's why actually we can say that we are one of the leading countries who are on the way to achieve the commitments that we have done, and that is due to solar mission that the government and everyone else has taken up. Green coal, we cannot do away completely with coal, that we know. So at least we can have coal utilization more greener, and that's why green coal is also being worked upon. Energy storage, either because of e-vehicles or even for grid level and behind the meter storage, storage technologies are also evolving. Cost-wise, they may not be really adoptable right now, but yes, technologies are available. And India is really doing a lot of work into these sectors. Just look at on your right-hand side, what are those? Biogas and biomass-based generation. Are the technologies available? Yes, we can say technologies are available. But dissemination is happening all over India? No, it is not happening. So there are many other constraints, there are many other limitations, not only technology availability. So that is the first example here. Waste disposal and recycling, I would say, and many people will differ with me, that technologies themselves are not available for the kind of waste that we experience, for the kind of waste that we generate. Technologies are not yet available. Still a lot of work is going on in this. Organic and natural farming, people have known about this. At least in India, there are many people who have known, tried this, but on a very large scale, it is not adoptable yet. So what I mean to say here is, when a good technology which will really help us in reducing carbon or reducing climate change, then there is not only the technology that matters. What matters, these are only few of the other factors. Definitely leadership with a vision, whether they really want India to really become carbon neutral or net neutral or zero emission or whatever, that vision, that is very much necessary. But after that, political and bureaucratic obstacles, there are a lot of policy issues, regulatory issues, flip-flops, taxation, and so on. So I can go on. Even in renewable energy, we face it every day in, day out. So this is another factor that will definitely have either a very smooth path for technology dissemination, or it will totally stop technology dissemination. citizens' understanding and also the priorities. Understanding, we have said, talked earlier, that knowledge availability, information availability may be a problem, but also the priorities. For many priorities, in the manner that the technologies are available and people expect, they don't follow those things, and they will not follow those things because their priorities are different. Collective will, whether we really are willing to change and whether we are willing to work, that is also another important factor. Some things, policies, regulations, technologies may be available everywhere, every state, all over India, even every district. But whether as an individual, we are really, collectively I'm talking about, whether we are really willing to work and change. And that, I feel, is a very, very, very limited and pathetic situation right now, at least in India. That's what I can say. So overall, what I mean here, and in a very limited time, that technology is not the constraint, but as some many people have said earlier, technology is also not the only solution. So I will stop here because I think there may be some discussion further, and back to you, Aditi.
Thank you, Arvind. Aditi, we can take some questions and then allow me 5 minutes to conclude the session.
Yes, sir. Prithviraj, can you ask the questions which you have compiled? And Arvind sir, thank you for the detailed account and all the practicalities and technicalities. Over to you, Prithviraj.
Am I audible, Aditi?
Yes,
yes. Yeah. Yes, you are.
Hello to all the respected speakers. Today I represent the millennial generation, that is the people born in 2000 or after. So my generation does not see climate change as or these solutions as a choice between to transition or not to transition. We kind of look at it as a choice between peaceful existence or a tormented existence, and the generation after me might not have this choice as well. So as Sarachandra sir actually pointed out about equity or justice, what about the question of intergenerational equity with regards to climate change? Because the decision makers of today are not going to be the most healthy or the most active citizens in the future. It is going to be us. But the decisions that are taken today are directly going to affect my next 50 to 60 years of my lifetime. So how to visualize intergenerational equity in decision making, and how to encourage the political will towards action on all these converging questions of climate change?
Should I try to answer that, Aditi?
Yes, sir, please. You and Anupam.
Yeah, so it's a very excellent question and very nicely put. Thank you. I think we can use the word equity in various ways. We can even extend the idea of equity to non-human beings and say the tiger has a right to live, and therefore we have no right to destroy the entire tiger habitat, right? And so equity is a very interesting and useful concept. There is a risk in stretching it too far, or then we are also confronted with the question, is equity towards other human beings today more or less important than equity towards the future and equity towards the tiger? Yeah, so we'll have these tough decisions to make. Whether we call it equity, we call it animal rights, we call it rights of future generations. So the problems don't go away, right? And I think what you will see is that very often people, when they say, I care about future generations, it implicitly mean their future generations. And so it's easier to appeal to the idea of intergenerational equity, because I'm saying, oh, my children and grandchildren have to survive, but I'm not actually thinking about the whole world's future generation. Yeah, because I'm still, as a person with a tribal origin, still thinking about me, my family, my clan, my jati, my whatever, right? And then their children in some sense. I've not become sort of Vishal in my perspective and really looking at the whole globe. Whereas if you have people who have already internalized the idea of intragenerational equity, that everybody today on earth deserves a dignified life, I think they will automatically add on the idea of intergenerational also. that everybody in the future also deserves a dignified life. But the reverse does not often work. That is why I would request you to start with intergenerational, to open your mind to that. I think automatically we will then become receptive to the idea of intergenerational also.
Anupam sir, would you like to add something to this?
Well, I think Dr. Lele has put it very well. I can perhaps only suggest that those of you who are not familiar with the Earth Charter may want to look at the Earth Charter and the four pillars it talks about for ethical decision making, for dealing with all the problems that we are confronted with. The four pillars are, first is respect and care for the community of life. The second pillar is about ecological integrity. The third pillar deals with social and economic justice, which includes intergenerational justice. And finally, the fourth pillar, which is about democracy, nonviolence, and peace. And nonviolence is not the absence of violence. So it's important for us to visit the Earth Charter and understand how we can integrate the ethical framework into decision-making in our business environments, as well as in our governments, so that we ensure that decisions are not purely run by economic considerations, but they have an ethical foundation to why we are doing what we are doing.
Thank you, sir. May I ask?
Can I just add one sentence here to put across the same argument in a single sentence? Is a globally connected citizen should take the moral and ethical responsibility for inequality, right? It's not what my action today is. It's not cause and effect of that action is not just on myself and my family. I think it's also about rest of the world, right? I think that's very important. I think ethical and moral decisions in our day-to-day activities has to be looked at how it's impacting the rest of the population.
Thanks a lot, sir. Now, I will ask Siddharth to share his question, and that will be the last question for this session.
Hi, Aditi, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to ask a question to you all. I'm 26 years old, so I still have a long life ahead of me, and I consider climate change a very, very big issue for our generations and generations next to come. So let me just go back briefly in time. So for the last 20 to 30 years, scientists have been warning us about, being ready for a pandemic in case there is a pandemic, and I don't think anyone listened to them. So the same thing can be applied to climate change issue. So my question to you is, do we foresee such a catastrophic event that can actually build up the seriousness to deal with climate change in the coming future? And secondly, what could those catastrophic incidences be, apart from what has already been established, like global warming and rising sea levels? Because that is, as we can see, not enough to actually build up that seriousness to act on it. So what could those events be like, and how can we move forward from that?
So, Sridhara, sir, if you could answer this.
Yeah, so, unlike pandemic, which sort of, we started with, one or two people getting, infected because of the zoonosis of a virus coming from an animal, it immediately starts spreading and the whole world was in a lockdown kind of a state. But, climate change, while it is, visible, while it is, one can experience, but it is still a slow killer. We don't realize this, because many times we also get adapted and because of some resilience we have in the system as well as in our body, particularly like pollution, right? And, pollution is increasing at almost yearly level for the last 50 years in places like Delhi, right? But every year in November, we realize that it's unbearable. And then, people still live, I think what's happening is the climate change, environmental degradation, all is a slow killer, and you may not see suddenly a catastrophe saying that one particular city is submerged overnight because of the sea water level raising and kind of stuff. And but we can see that thousands and thousands of people are affected in a variety of different places. Simply because the world is large and so many people are in this world, we may not see the kind of catastrophe what we experienced in 2020 because of the pandemic. But I think that's where, you know, our understanding of the world and inequality and the impact of the climate change and it has to be a little bit more, you know, it has to come from education, it has to come from understanding the problem. And you won't experience it, you know, the way you experience the pandemic.
Can I just come in response to that question as well? My take is that yes, Dr. Sushila, what you said is very right. It is not immediate effect like the pandemic, and it's slowly happening. And in fact, that is the reason why I took the bold decision to try to connect environment and economy. Because it is when the economy starts pinching, then people sit up. So we have come to a level now, and I will take this opportunity to just say a few words before concluding this session. We have come to a level, we have come to a stage where we are asking very serious, searching questions that do not have easy answers. So Siddharth, thank you for sort of kick-starting this discussion on what to do and how will it happen. So let me go back. And Anupam said, containing human greed, greed today is economical aspiration. How do we contain? Just now at the pandemic, we found that when the threat to life came, life and livelihood came, everybody forgot about economics. It is that kind of a situation that can drive the whole issue. But again, unless there is a huge global calamity due to climate change or environmental degradation, that may not happen. Sarachandra Raja said, who is we? Well, it's difficult to answer, and yet there can be an answer that we consists of three components. We is, to begin with, of course, is individuals, groups, and households, and so on and so forth. What we can do is what we are really meaning we. Some bit we can do, some bit we can hope to influence. Influence who? Influence the government, that's second entity. So we means we, the people. We means the government. And if at all, there's a third sector that can really make a difference, it is the industry. Commercial entities and the industry. So I would say that the answer to who is we is a very complex one. In a very simplified form, it could be just this, the components. And of course, like Dr. Sushila said, education is crucial, but then education has to be focused on what really matters. Education has to be focused on decentralization, and that education must be fruitful in gaining what you want to do in your life. So climate jobs, are they on top? Not yet, but maybe someday. And finally, coming to technology, as Arvind very nicely put it up, that many things are actually happening, but not enough and not at the fast rate that's required. Why? Again, because there is no demand from the people. Policies change when people insist that the policy must change. When the people's voice gets real loud and clear, then politicians and policymakers also sit up knowing that there is no way out. It is this kind of thing that will happen. But the other aspect of technology, and again, Arvind Karandika put it very nicely, there is a kind of a visual thinking that technology will solve everything. Technology cannot solve everything. Technology is a tool. Who operates the tool, who controls the tool? It's a human being. So it again comes back to the whole thing, what Anupam said, can we contain human greed? So I don't know if we have that answer. The objective of this conference was a very daring step by me and my colleagues and my seniors in PIC, who thought it is worth getting into this kind of dialogue, because somebody has to start this dialogue, something will come out, and yes, of course, we will produce a comprehensive conference proceedings, and we'll share it with you all. But this is not the end, this is the start. We are actually starting a new dialogue. We are actually trying to address many issues that have not been addressed in the context that we are doing. And of course, there is a large caveat that we have felt in the Indian context. We know that we cannot change the global climate change, but you also know that we can make a big difference. So it is in that kind of a scenario that we have planned this conference together. I must confess, if there is anyone to be blamed for the wrong choice of topics or people or whatever you want to call it, you'll have to blame me. But I'm happy that we did that. And I think there's a lot of good sense has come out of it, a lot of good understanding has come out of it. And that has been the main plus side. So I would like to thank everyone who contributed. I think in a conference like this, time is always at a short premium, but we try to do maximum so that there is a collection of thoughts together. Thank you to all speakers of the session, the fourth session, and thank you to the questions that have come up. I was watching the chat screen on that. Many questions came up and many people have answered that. I think that's a major plus that happens in a Zoom medium like this, online medium like this. So I'll sign off now as far as this session is concerned. Aditi, do you have to close this? You are on mute. Unmute yourself.
There is just one question which crops up every time during these discussions, and if Charachandra sir could answer it in a very short span. Can we include population control as a concrete measure in environment economic policy?
I've already answered the question in the chat window, but just to summarize, I think population growth is definitely a driver of pressure on the environment. That's true across the globe. Developed countries solve the problem through over a 100-150 year period, mostly by externalizing population onto other continents and then rapidly improving their material well-being at the cost of the environment. Now we are being expected to achieve the same demographic transition in two decades and with a limited resource starting from an impoverished position. So I think we have to be careful not to convert the population problem to one of control and coercion. And more about making the demographic transition possible. And there are enough states now in India which have already made that transition. There's good evidence that it is not about economic growth, but about bottom-up development and women's empowerment. Kerala is an example. Tamil Nadu is an example. So I think there's a lot of hope if we take a non-coercive approach.
Let me come in here, Aditi, and let us remember what Priyadarshini Karve said yesterday. She said, sustainability and population growth will adjust by themselves. She said, if you keep on going like this, maybe our population will go down and then it will automatically, the sustainability will emerge. In a lighter sense, well, that may be the answer that we don't want to hear, but that may be the answer that we may have to tolerate. So, okay, Aditi.
Yes, yes, sir. So I thank all the speakers in the panel discussion for such a varied topics and so much insightful talks and discussion. We will now move to the next segment of the conference, which is the special address by our Pune's very own advocate Vandana Chavan, Honorable MP Rajya Sabha. She is known for especially bringing up issues like air pollution, climate change resilience, and urban forests in Rajya Sabha. She is also actively involved in many environmental initiatives and has been instrumental in realizing them. We are lucky to that you could join us today, ma'am, and I request you to deliver your special address on climate economic challenges for India. Thank you.
May I come in here and extend a warm welcome to Vandana ji. We are all very encouraged that you are taking so much interest. Ultimately, we have to reach out to political leadership to make the changes that we are talking about. So we all look forward to your address. Most welcome. Please go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you, Amitabh ji. I hope I'm audible. So at the outset, let me congratulate PIC and Climate Collective for organizing this conference, the dialogue on energy, environment, and economy, an extremely important issue of our generation and the future generations. Amitabh Malik ji, I've seen the passion with which you have been driving this issue, I'm not surprised that you have got such an distinguished panel of experts over the last 2 days, yesterday and today. I would like to thank you at this juncture for making me a part of this two-day very, very important deliberation. I'm sure a lot of the speakers must have mentioned this even at the inauguration. There must have been mentioned that we are all concerned about the melting of ice sheets, the sea level rise, the extreme weather conditions due to the change in global weather patterns, the floods, the droughts, the cyclones, the acidification and oxygen depletions that seriously impact ocean life, extinction of species, disease, food and water shortages are all happening at a pace faster than scientists and experts ever predicted. The phenomena of climate change is happening and impacting in less or more form all over the world. As far as India is concerned, we rank 5th in the Global Climate Risk Index 2020. Its geographical position and varied landforms positions us amongst the most vulnerable countries to climate change. Sadly, India incurs tremendous losses, revenue losses due to climate events. According to the United Nations Disaster Risk Reduction Global Assessment Report, in 2015, India incurred an average annual loss of approximately $9.8 billion per year due to varying disasters. Of this, an annual loss of $7.4 billion every year due to floods alone. Based on the IPCC 2018 report also, it is estimated that if trends in climate change and land holdings in India continue at the current pace, some 600 million people, which is roughly half the population of India, may directly and indirectly be impacted due to climate change conditions. We have to realize that climate change is no more an environmental concern. It is a social, economic, and developmental concern. And most of all, it is an existential concern for several people and the population of different countries who are vulnerable. In spite of understanding the multifaceted implications and impacts of climate change and the struggle of countries to strike a balance between environment and economy, the question is, have we done enough? Are we doing enough? As a global community, we have come together on several occasions, and I feel proud to say that India has been a very active participant at the international forums. In 1972, the United Nations for the first time convened a conference at Stockholm to discuss issues pertaining to pollution, depleting natural resources, economic development, environment, and sustainable development. 20 years later, in 1992, the world community once again met at Rio, and on several later occasions, all these marked landmark decisions and declarations for recognition of the problem and to commit to a common responsibility to address this. In 2000, the Millennium Summit established the 8 Millennium Development Goals, the MDGs as we call them, on developmental issues arising out of inequities, touching lives of people who are deprived and vulnerable. In 2015, the MDG agenda was renewed by adopting the Agenda 2030 with its 17 sustainable goals, resulting in widening of areas for action. According to me, climate change forms the bedrock of this agenda. The agenda not only lays down a specific goal, goal number 13 on climate action, but almost all others also directly and indirectly address the same. To mention a few, goal 6, clean water and sanitation. Goal 7, affordable and clean energy. Goal 11, sustainable cities and communities. Goal 12, responsible consumption and production. Goal 14, life below water. Goal 15, life on land, and the list can go on. Then of course came the COP21 in Paris on 12th December 2015. Parties to the UNFCCC reached a landmark agreement to combat climate change and to accelerate and intensify the action and investments needed for sustainable low carbon future. The central aim of the Paris Agreement was to strengthen the global response to the threat of climate change by keeping global temperature rise this century well below 2 degrees Celsius, above pre-industrial levels, and to pursue efforts to limit the temperature increase even further to 1.5 degrees Celsius. India's response to all these international conventions has been extremely positive, quick, and encouraging. Just to give a few points, during the tenure of Mrs. Gandhi as the Prime Minister, our country witnessed certain important constitutional amendments. I won't go into the details, and legislations concerning environment. During the tenure of Mr. Rajiv Gandhi as the Prime Minister, we saw the devolution of power to the local self-governments to administer effectively at local government. The 73rd and 74th amendments to the Constitution were introduced, promoting, in a sense, Agenda 21, which was declared in the Rio conference, which says, think globally, act locally. As Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh Ji put in the formation of the National Action Plan on Climate Change with its 8 missions, making us the first ever country in the world to take such an initiative. And now, presently, the leadership role taken by Sri Narendra Modi at the COP21 in Paris, and the aggressive follow-up and action on adding renewable energy, which is the most imperative transition to the energy basket of our country. In spite of all this, the question that comes to our minds is, are we doing enough? And the answer most certainly is in the negative. Are we really serious about the green or sustainable pathway that we talk about? The recent uproar over the EIA notification 2020, the distribution of coal blocks, the environmental clearances being given left, right, and center make us doubt whether we really walk the talk. A lot more remains still to be done. Post-COVID-19, as routines start to unlock, normalcy slowly resumes, and countries move towards rebuilding their economies, a huge window of opportunity has opened up to work out recovery plans that can shape the 21st century economy in ways that are clean, green, healthy, safe, and more resilient. The slow and steady unlocking of the COVID-19 crisis is an unprecedented opportunity for a profound systemic shift to a more sustainable economy that works for both people and the planet. Problems, considering that electricity contributes 33%, industry 24%, agriculture 18%, transport 10%, and building construction, etc., another 10% of the total carbon emission. Further, considering that agriculture is badly hit due to idiosyncrasies of nature, cities are becoming heat islands and guzzlers of energy, producers of enormous waste, air pollution now becoming a norm in every city, affecting health, carelessness impacting biodiversity, and further considering what has been said today, that we will be the largest emitter in 2050, we certainly have a lot on our hands. I have worked with the city government for 15 years, and if I may say so, it has been, or it is even now, chaotic to say the least. Nobody knows what's happening, nobody knows how to address issues which will impact climate, which will impact the development of cities and future. And to make us wonder, where do we actually start? The one vertical which seems to be playing a proactive role is the business and industry. Apart from initiatives of the government at all levels, business and industry seems to be playing a significant role to significantly reduce emissions. Of course, I need not say a lot more needs to be done in that direction. But I would like to mention because it's nice to talk about some positive things also. So I would like to mention two very interesting observations on corporate engagement in addressing issues of emission reduction and conservation, which I came across when I was reading some articles. In 2009, when MIT's Sloan Management Review first surveyed businesses about sustainability efforts, it found most doing only what is necessary to meet regulatory requirements. 5 years later, the survey had a different story. Nearly 2/3 of companies said sustainability was the top of their agendas, which fewer than half had said earlier. What changed? The CEO's sense of green initiatives worth. According to Patricia and Jack Phillips, authors of the Green Scorecard, today most, if not all, businesses recognize that climate change is a problem. And they write that smart companies use their environmental strategies to build competitive advantage. Another interesting observation is that of the Intel Corporation. Intel instituted annual Environmental Excellence Awards, whereby the company gives recognition to those who had implemented innovative and effective projects. In 2017, such projects accounted for a reduction of 21,000 million tons carbon dioxide equivalent, conservation of 183 million gallons of water, 120 tons of waste reduction, and energy savings of nearly 16 million kilowatt hour. So this is something which is possible if a proactive role has to be played. Besides these, there is another heartening observation, and that is that 50% of top 30 international industries listed in Dow Jones are planning to use or already using 100% renewable energy. To my mind, it came that which were these companies? Were there any Indian companies? So the good story, again, the good news was that India, in a survey undertaken by Carbon Disclosure Project in 2019 of countries committed to science-based targets, India ranked fifth, and that's not bad. However, the same report also stated by not measuring and reporting forest-related risk and opportunities, Indian companies might be at a competitive disadvantage in the global market and will face adverse effects if deforestation and climate change is not on their supply chain. The report also observed that India's 26 million micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises are especially vulnerable to climate change. So here too, we have a lot to do on the platter. Post-COVID-19, as we build our economies, out of the many steps of precautions that we must take, I would like to touch upon five. Not that they are the top five, but they are around myths which exist amongst businesses and especially the governments. We need to ensure, one is we need to ensure that in a rush to fix the economy after the COVID situation, we do not discount the aspect of sustainability. And here I would like to quote the Israeli historian and celebrated author, Yuval Noah Harari, who writes, "The decisions people and governments take in the next few weeks will probably shape the world for the years to come." We need to work towards doing away with the myths that addressing environmental concerns would cause loss in profits. And the cases which I cited earlier go to show the contrary. Point number two, governments need to push and encourage aspect of sustainability without fearing that the GDP would get affected. Since 2000, some environmentally conscious nations started working on reducing their carbon footprint. More than 20 countries have proved that reducing carbon dioxide emissions did not reduce their GDP, instead considerably increased it. And I would like to, out of the list of 21, I would like to point out some of the countries. Bulgaria, they brought down their carbon emission by 5%, so minus 5%, and the change in GDP was plus 62%. It was Hungary, minus 24% as far as carbon emission reduction, and change in GDP was plus 29%. Then Romania, minus 22%, change in GDP, plus 65%. Slovakia, minus 22% of reduction in carbon dioxide emission, change in GDP, 75%. Ukraine, minus 29% carbon dioxide in GDP, plus 49%. These are the smaller countries. But even there are countries like Germany, USA, UK, which also find their place in this entire list. The third point I would like to come to is we have to understand that environment and economy should be considered as two sides of the same coin, and they have to go hand in hand. It is a fact that economic activity threatens the environment, and the situation is worsening. We have witnessed it over the years. But we have to realize that we have reached a stage where we are in a state of planetary emergency. If we have to survive as a race and ensure a healthy future for our children, we will have to adopt sustainable developmental patterns. Taking note of the fact that the youth of several countries, including ours, have started questioning governments over environmental concerns, this is a lesson to the government, businesses, and individuals with heavy carbon footprints to realize enough is enough. The point which I would like to make next is my fourth point, where we need to rethink as to what exactly do we mean by economic growth. We have several economists on the panel, and I'm not an economist anywhere close to that. So this is a layman's expression, but it has been very beautifully, it has beautifully come out in some of your speeches during the day. So we need to rethink as to what exactly do we mean by economic growth. The conventional method of measuring an economy is the GDP, which is the total value of all final goods and services produced in a country over a certain period of time. Later on, economists thought people and their capabilities should be the ultimate criteria for assessing development of a country, not just economic growth at all and alone. So the measure of HDI, the Human Development Index, was born. A new concept for an indicator that is floating is the green GDP, which should take into consideration planetary health and human development. And the last point which I want to make is the fifth point: we need to revisit our costing system. I think Dr. Lely did mention this in a very, very wonderful way. One that would help promote environment and at the same time encourage non-polluting technological interventions wherever possible. We need to make a conscious effort to move away from the present costing system and make sure that we actually include all environmental costs in the goods which are hidden, which are which have a footprint but are not taken into account. This has to be accounted in the goods and services that we use. We need to encourage the production and consumption of technologies which do not damage the environment. This could be also a strong case to subsidize the development of technological alternatives in order to speed up the process and make it more attractive. And in conclusion, I wish to end with two quotes. One is by Thomas Friedman in his book, Hot, Flat, and Crowded, which really makes us raise our antennas. He says, imagine a world without forest. Imagine a world without corals. Imagine a world without fish. Imagine a world where rivers flow only in rainy season. Not only is that possible in more and more places, it is possible in our lifetime. If we don't develop a system for preservation of biodiversity and natural resources. And that is, I think, the message that each one of us have to take back. And secondly, United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres, who warned that a point of no return on climate change is in sight and hurtling towards us. And therefore, my question, as I had put it, was what are we waiting for? But I'm not going to say what are we waiting for. Each one of us on this planet Earth has to become aware of climate change and start asking this question, what am I waiting for? Taking a cue from the speakers who have spoken in the earlier session. Thank you very much, Amitabhji, for giving me an opportunity to share some of my thoughts here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andanathai. Wonderful having you talking to us about your experience, about your understanding. I think this has been a very, very appropriate finale to this whole conference. I will take this opportunity now to say a few things, say a few words in summary, to highlight what we have gone through, what we have experienced in the last 2 years, that last 2 days. And after that, I will request our Vice President, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, to say a concluding remarks. So to summarize this whole conference, I will have to confess and accept that this was a very bold decision and a very bold experiment to try to connect environmental priorities with economic progress, economic growth. After being a defense scientist for many years, I've got now converted into an environmentalist, and therefore I can understand the agitation of the environmentalist that perhaps this conference did not talk about biodiversity, it did not talk about the typical things that environmentalists speak. But again, I apologize and say that the whole focus was to identify how we can connect the environmental priority with economic priority, which unfortunately continues to be the people's priority, the politicians' priority, and the world's priority. Very recent, just now in the previous section, Sarachandra later said, we must stop watching the ticker tape. He pointed out that whatever goes on in the media, TV, etc., there is always a sensitivity about the economic measure, going up, going down, what is it? And that seems to drive our whole life. So I thought, why not we also kind of try to latch in to that kind of a sensitivity where the environmental priority, environmental degradation, the hardship that human beings will have to tolerate in the future also gets linked to that ticker tape. And I feel, maybe madly optimistic, that we are coming very close to the situation where environmental degradation, climate change, etc., will start hurting us, not so much in terms of lifestyle or the quality of life, but also in terms of economy. And when the shoe pinches there, I hope people will understand that the symptoms are going to get much worse unless we do some reform, reset, and so on and so forth. My friend very recently said, just now previously said, containing human greed will be a necessity requirement. In the past, human greed became contained only when there was a calamity. Even very recently, COVID showed us that when people's life was threatened, the economy took the back seat. Are we going to wait for that kind of a situation where a huge calamity will wake us up saying that, my God, economy can wait, we have to do something differently? It is that something differently is what we are all trying to define, what we are all trying to understand. And then Sharad Leary asked, who is we? And then I answered that we is, of course, the three components. We is we, the citizen. The other part of the we is, of course, the government. And the third part which can really make a difference is the corporate sector, industry, commercial, etc. So if all the three components of this we put together their mind, their head, their thinking caps, maybe we can start thinking in terms of what needs to change. Obviously, something has to change. Many people point out the population problem, but truly it's not really a population problem, because if we do not prosper, if we do not sustain livelihood and the life, population will automatically decline. I mean, these are the realities of the life, where we are coming to a crossroad where a decision is required now and right away. In fact, we are in a situation where the right decisions should have been taken 10 years ago. But looking forward, we have only 10 years, according to the World Scientist Body. We have only 10 years to put things right, or at least start putting things right. If we don't do that, then that opportunity is lost. It is with that urgency and with that earnestness that we try to get very bold and organize this conference. I'm very happy that we created a Pune International Center, the kind of a think tank forum that can take up this kind of challenges, and where We as the elders in the committee, in elders in the governing council, we actually think that this is the kind of difference we hope to make a difference. So all in all, this has been a very wonderful 2 days. I think number of issues have come up, number of solutions have emerged, number of ideas have emerged, number of alarms have emerged. Like today, Dr. Parandikar said, by 2050, we may be the largest emitter in the world. And that scares me, not because it's an emotive issue, but it is because then we cannot really persuade others to reduce the carbon signature if we become the largest emitter. So we have to have the international clout to be able to tell the world, we believe this has to be done, we are doing this, and therefore you must do this. So everything, whether it's environment, whether it's climate change, whether it's economics, whether it's politics, whether it's international relations, I think we are trying to put together everything together under the one roof today, yesterday and today. I'm willing to think, daring to think that the glass is half full, because we are actually addressing these whole issues. There are many empty parts of the glass. I think we'll start filling if we can actually think about the kind of changes that we must do. Before I conclude and invite Dr. Kelkar to say his concluding remarks, let me take this opportunity to thank each and everyone, particularly the invited speakers who readily agreed to our invitation, have put in their own effort, have taken out their time from their busy schedules, spent time with us, shared their views, told us so many new things that we learned. And of course, to the hundreds and hundreds of people who have been attending, right now it has come down to 75, but at the peak of it, there were more than touching 200 people. So I have to say thank you to everybody. Without this conference could not have happened. Before I invite Dr. Kelkar, I must also say my young team of climate researchers in my PICEECC group, youngest is 20 years, oldest is 32, and of course, if you take me out, their average is 25. So, Dr. Kelkar,
yeah.
On to you, please. Concluding remarks.
Honorable Vandanaji, my distinguished colleague, Professor Amitabh Malik, and friends. Last 2 days has been a great learning 48 hours for me. I learned a lot from our distinguished speakers and also from very, very eloquent remarks of Honorable Vandanaji, our dear Member of Parliament of Pune. I've been sort of thinking, what does it mean to me, and what does it mean, how do I start looking at this problem? And it seems to me that we have two challenges. One, decarbonization, and second is poverty removal. Now, I think the challenge is for putting our thinking cap on our head and find out a way by which there will be no antagonistic objectives. That means, can we think of instruments which can achieve both? Not only we help to decarbonize, but also at the same time make a frontal attack on poverty and hunger. And that's where I think the real challenge is going to lie in terms of thinking creatively. It seems that one obvious instrument comes to my mind, and looking at the historical experience and what's happening, even contemporary success stories. Just now, Honorable Member of Parliament mentioned 4 or 5 very successful examples of the European countries. And it struck me that all these 3-4 countries have one thing in common. that they have become a part of the large common market and become far more open economies. I mean, they started trading. That instead of sort of they change their trade policy and become much more open for world trade, and that allows you to meet both the objectives. I think something in India also going to do that. We had to be far more open to the world trade. I think this present trend of protectionism is not a way of meeting these objectives. We have to be far more open because that's the only thing we're going to get access to the world and also give to the world what we are best. So another point I think is that the point was made by another speaker and it struck me. The real problem, challenge for India is our rich, or what you call the haves. I think we had our haves in India will have to change a lot. It's really, poor already facing all these constraints. There's nothing new for them. But it's caused by the haves, and I think haves have to really bite the bullet, confront themselves, their own conscience, that they're the part of the problem today, they have to become part of the solution. And one thing I think PIC will have in terms of work program for next year is Professor Malik to think how we can persuade haves to become a solution rather than a problem in this India's challenge. Because my worry is, and if we don't act, the rest of the world is not going to become accommodative. The rest of the world is going to be very harsh. This world is very harsh, the rest of the world will be even harsher if we have our own haves don't do their own duties and contribute towards meeting the challenge of decarbonization. So I learned a lot, and I think, as Professor Malik said, I'm truly impressed by the energy and ideas of our young colleagues. And I hope that they have jotted down all the points which came up, and I expect them to work out a work program for next year's for the PIC's policy research and policy outreach program. And that, of course, we will be discussing in the coming weeks how we do go about it. So once again, I want to thank Vandana ji for her very eloquent summing up and very thoughtful lecture. And Professor Malik for taking up this challenge of organizing this, because when he first mentioned that to me several months ago, frankly, I was somewhat skeptical whether we have ability within the PIC to do this. But he has pulled it off by mobilizing best possible intellectual resources all over India, even abroad also. So, Professor Malik, warm thanks to you and warm congratulations. And also warm congratulations to all your colleagues who worked very, very hard on this project. So I now want to conclude this conference formally, and I want to thank by thanking again one and everyone who participated in this yajna. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Kekar. We are happy that to have listened and been able to understand such a vast array of ideas and research in just 2 days' time. I thank Dr. Rajiv Kumar and Advocate Vandana Chavan for their insightful addresses. I thank our speakers, Dr. Chirag Dhara, Dr. Ramprasad Sen Gupta, Dr. Gurudas Nulkar, Dr. Ashok Khosla, Dr. Deepak Das Gupta, Dr. Peter Heck, Dr. Priyadarshini Karve, Dr. Rahul Paipanandikar, Mr. Ajit Kapadia, Dr. Saun Ray, Dr. Nitant Mate, Dr. Anupam Saraf, Dr. Sharad Chandra Lele, Dr. L.S. Shashidhara, and Mr. Arvind Karandikar for their wonderful sessions. We are grateful to Ecological Society Pune and Indian Network on Ethics and Climate Change, INEC, for all the cooperation. We thank PIC President, Vice President, Director, Associate Director, and all the PIC staff for the incessant support and help. We thank everyone who has indirectly or directly helped in organizing this conference. Our team is grateful to Professor Malik for giving us this opportunity to be a part of the conference. And thanks to all the audience and the participants for joining us and for the interactive chat room, and we hope to stay connected for climate action. Thank you.